Good morning, everyone. Sorry for the delay. We are still transmitting from home. It's been a few weeks. We had taken a pause to be able to, and I'm not being rude, I'm just looking to put the transmissions on the various different, on our different pages. So, my name is Joaquin Gonzalez. I'm the senior pastor of Pure Grace Ministries, for those of you who don't know who I am. And we have been transmitting virtually since the pandemic began here in New York. We were in a state of lockdown, so everything got locked down and weren't able to have our normal services. And so now we're, you know, back in the saddle, so to speak. And I want to bring you and give you an update on Pastor Sharon, who you will be hearing from her later. She's actually going to be here singing a song for us as we get ready to close. You know, for those of you who didn't know, she did contract COVID, and she's been recovering very well. The Lord's been very gracious to her with regards to that. And, you know, we're just really so grateful for the mercies of God and the grace of God in keeping her safe. And it's been really, really a wonderful thing for us to be able to, you know, just really see God's hand at work, and everything has been such a blessing to us in just her continued good reports that she's been getting, the fact that the symptoms were not as severe as they could have been. Just God's grace, and test after test, she just came through with it in flying colors. You know, obviously we were all concerned, and you know, but just God was just so good. God was just so good to us. God was very gracious to us. And I think to our Pure Grace church family, who have been, we've been apart for quite a while now with everything that's been going on, and we just thank you for your prayers, and thank you for you just kind of just being with us and in prayer and sending text messages, and you know, all of that has been really an encouraging thing for us, very much so. So I just wanted to, like I said, just give that update. Sharon's been doing well, thank God, and you know, we've just been, I gotta tell you, I can't tell you how grateful I am for the Lord's grace and His mercy throughout this whole season that we've been going through. It's been a season of great change and great, you know, having to modify even basic things like going shopping, you know, things like of that nature, and we've had to learn to adapt. We've had to learn to adapt to this new normal for the church, for the country, and we've just been grateful how the Lord has just been merciful and gracious to us throughout it all. And, you know, there's been a lot of changes. There's been a lot of things that God has done for us. And actually, I'm here. I'm just handing this over to Pastor Sharon. And we've been able to navigate through. These have been some very troubling waters. These have been some very difficult waters. There's just been so many things going on. And through it all, the voice of the Lord can be heard. You know, when Pastor Sharon preached a message a couple of years ago called When God Feels a Million Miles Away, and many times when we go through difficult times, He could just seem like He's just so far away and so distant that we can't seem to connect with Him. And at times like this, where you're kind of forced into modifying the way your daily lifestyle is, modifying what you do on a day-to-day basis, your routine just gets totally thrown out of whack. You know, working from home, adjusting to that new environment is very challenging. But everything happens for a reason. All things work together for good. To those who love God, those that are the called according to His purpose. For those whom He foreknew, He did predestine to be conformed into the image of His Son. Everything that happens in our lives is not an accident. It's not just an outbreak or these things. They happen under the sovereign will of God. And it's an opportunity for us to take those pauses and to try to see, what is God trying to tell me? What is the Lord saying to me as an individual? Here, you know, across the world, this pandemic has affected virtually every nation under the sun. And nations and peoples have had to adapt the way they live their usual life, the way they run their businesses, the way they run their countries, their cities, their towns. Everything's been upheaval, right? The churches have been shut down for a long time. There's a real crisis going on. But these are the opportunities that, when yielded to in the Spirit, allows us to be transformed, allows us to transition from who we were to who we were destined to be. Because the will of God is for us to be conformed into the image of Jesus. So the Father will use various different ways and various different means to get our attention and to create a catalyst in our lives to transform us into the image of Jesus. So this message that I'm going to share with you today was birthed from this whole crisis with COVID-19. The trials and the tribulations that we've all been going through to one degree or another during this whole crisis. And the Lord spoke to my heart during my quiet times, and this message was birthed. So at some point I will continue with my teaching going through Paul's epistles, but for now we're going to spend a little bit of time in talking about the quiet life. And today's message is learning to live a quiet life. You know, the verse that we're going to use today is, make it your ambition to lead a quiet life, to mind your own business, and to work with your hands. And you may think like, wow, that's kind of interesting verse. But think about it this way. When was the last time that you heard a message that told you to aspire to be quiet, to live quietly, right? To just kind of, in a way, mind your own business. Just kind of be settled and be still. To seek the stillness rather than the noise. To be happy and content with what you have instead of aspiring to do more things, the promotion, the this, the that, and the other thing. Think about it for a minute. They're not very popular topics. And, I mean, I didn't do an extensive search, but I did look into things. And many of the, most of the messages that are out there, there's even books and conferences that are there to kind of teach us how to increase our faith, right? How to get more out of God, basically. Increase your faith, work up your faith, stir up your faith, to walk in favor, right? That's a popular one. How to draw the favor of God, and things of that nature. So it's more about what you can get more out of God rather than what you already have. It doesn't focus, it makes you feel that you're in the deficit column. You're lacking something. You're lacking more faith, more courage. You're lacking more prayer life, more of a quiet time. You know, you should, you need. It never takes it from the perspective of what do you already have. I'm going to tell you a secret that may blow your mind, or you may tune off after I tell you this. The thing that all these books and messages are trying to get you to pursue, the things that they're trying to transform and change you into, guess what? It's already yours. You'd be like, what? How is that possible? It is already yours. The things that those books are trying to get you to achieve and to pursue and to go after are already yours. And you're like, what? Okay. Let's Bible interpret Bible. The things that we pursue, what? Money to take care of our families, right? A job, prestige, favor, more time, open doors, right? Walking with the Lord and all these things. And, just pursue. And then you're just kind of running on that treadmill and making no progress, right? You get up depressed instead of feeling propelled forward. Instead of feeling a success, you wake up being depressed. I'm going to read you from 1 Corinthians 3, 21 through 23, and this is the Good News translation. I love this translation of this verse. And here's what it says. No one then should boast about what human beings can do. Actually, everything belongs to you. Paul, Apollos, Peter, this world, life and death, the present and the future. All these things belong to you. All these things are yours. And you belong to Christ, and Christ belongs to God. That's the Good News Translation of the verse. All things are already yours. But then you may say, well, Pastor, really, I don't know. If everything is mine, why am I not happy? Why am I still struggling? Why don't I feel like I have these things and these things are mine? And that's a great question. And I will tell you the answer that the Lord gave me. You're not being still. You are not being still. God says, be still and know that I am God. Now, let me tell you something. This is a verse that we quote a lot in this church. And these are the things that being still is not something that is natural to your flesh. Your flesh doesn't want to be still. It doesn't understand or comprehend what does it mean to be still. It doesn't get that. And it's not pursuing stillness. The flesh never pursues stillness. The spirit pursues stillness. Why? Because he says, be still and know that I am God. And I'm going to read to you several translations of what this means in different versions. This is the NASB, cease striving. The CSB, stop your fighting. The CEV, our God says, calm down. God's Word translation says, let's go. Let go of your concerns. The ISB says, be in awe. Be in awe is being in awe of what? Of God, of his goodness, of the finished work of the cross, of the immense love that God has for you. And to be in awe of that. And the JPS Tanakh 1917 says, let be. Now, does any of that give you the indication that you need to be doing something? More working up sweat, right? The priest in the Old Testament in the tabernacle wore linen clothing because no sweat could be permitted in the presence of God. It was the very personification of rest. Linen was white, and linen is symbolic of righteousness. White is symbolic of divine righteousness. Righteousness was given to you as a gift. It was imparted to you and imputed to you on that cross, and it becomes yours when you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. It's an imputation. It is a gift. You didn't do anything to earn it. And here's a shocker for you. There's nothing you can do to lose it. You cannot lose your salvation. Salvation is eternal. It is a gift. It is a gift from God. When you are born again, you become a child of God, washed by the blood of Jesus. God's very spirit comes to dwell within you. You still live in the same old body, but there's a new tenant living inside that body. And that's the real you if you're a child of God. You can never, no matter what you do, no matter how many blood transfusions you have in the natural, you can never stop being the child of your parents. You have their DNA. There's nothing that you can do. You can denounce and renounce your lineage, your parents, your in the natural. But you cannot alter the DNA. I'm here to tell you that from a spiritual perspective, you cannot alter the divine DNA that is in you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. If you were dirty, if you were unrighteous, if you were a sinner saved by grace and all these other things, then God himself cannot dwell inside of you, because God cannot dwell in a dirty house, in an unsanctified house. And we see that in the Old Testament. All the utensils, everything that was used to create the tabernacle was sanctified by blood. Blood sanctified those things. Once those articles were sanctified, they were now holy and set apart for the Lord. Nothing could alter and change it. So that's the thing that I want you to get you to see. You know, being still is knowing who God is and knowing who you are and what you mean to him. That's being still. There's a sense of feeling. You know, you cease striving. You cease from trying to figure things out. So I want to go back to what we said before. All things are ours. When you know you belong to God, everything that God has is yours. The gold, the silver, and the cattle on a thousand hills are the Lord's. And you are the Lord's, and the Lord is yours. God is not somewhere far, far away. He's right here. And he only speaks, as we see in Elijah, in a small, still voice. He's not in the hurricane, he's not in the whirlwind, he's not in the fire. He is in that small, still voice. You have to be still long enough to hear that voice, or else you're going to keep running and running and running and making no progress. And the only person who wins short term, who wins is the enemy. You don't, because you're seeking to earn an approval that's already yours. God himself has already sealed you into the day of redemption. And what is the day of redemption? The day when we hear that trumpet blast, and the last thing to be saved is your body, your physical body, will be transformed in an instant. And you will all be caught up to meet him in the air and be with him always. And you will see him face to face. The same one who hung on that cross, who went into the grave for 3 days, who rose from the dead, walked among men for 40 days, and ascended into heaven. He will return for you. In the clouds you will meet him. And you'll be with him forever. But you can start to enjoy this wonderful Father who sent his son Jesus to die for you right now. The pleasures of heaven and the joys of heaven are to be enjoyed right now. You don't put it on hold for someday. Someday, somewhere out there, they're yours now. Kingdoms, dominion, resources, they are yours. But are you looking at your lack, or are you looking at your fullness? Do you see the cross as something that you have to aspire to? Something that you have to bury and carry, bearing your cross? That was before he died. We don't bear a cross. We stand straight with no weight. Jesus said in Mark 11:28, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Rest doesn't come from retirement. Rest doesn't come from a 401k. Rest doesn't come from a day off. It comes from coming to the one who bore all your sins and iniquities and your sicknesses and infirmities on that cross. That is the true way of finding rest. You have to cease your striving, and you have to live day, one day at a time, one situation at a time, one medical report at a time. God, life is lived one step at a time. And my prayer for you is that you would have a hunger for the Word of God, and that you would see the Word of God not as a book of rules and don'ts, but as a love letter from your Father. Because from Genesis to Revelations, you see that heart that beats for you. God is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. But he said, I will never, ever again, he swore by his name, ever, ever again be angry with you. And in Jeremiah, he says, I have loved you with an everlasting love. There is nothing you can do, nothing you can do to sever that love, to taint that love, to diminish that love for you. There is nothing. Paul said in Romans, nothing can separate us from the love of God. And that nothing means you too. And instead of it giving you a license to let me just do whatever I want, it should give you peace to say that I don't have to try to earn it. Just enjoy your father. Enjoy your daddy. And so, today's Father's Day, and I want to wish a happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there. Because whether you have biologically conceived children or not, you are a father to someone. Someone looks up to you. Someone you counsel. Someone, it could be a little league, it could be your soccer, whatever it is. People look up to you. Young men look up to you, go to you for counsel. People look up to you. You're a father. We are all fathers and mothers, whether we have given birth to children or not. There are people who look to us for counsel and advice, and there are people who we nurture through our prayers and support. But on this Father's Day, and I hope that I won't start crying, which will probably be very difficult for me, but I want to tell you about my daddy. And I'm not talking about my earthly daddy, who has gone to be with the Lord, who is now experiencing the fullness of God's love in heaven. I want to talk to you about my heavenly daddy. And I call him Papa when I pray. I have grown very comfortable in calling him daddy and calling him Papa because of the long and rich and loving relationship that we have had for 53 years that I've been on this earth. My daddy is a great dad. I mean, you know, night or day, no matter what I'm going through, when I don't understand things,
when I'm afraid, when things become overwhelming, those arms are always open wide for me to receive me. When I have been rejected here on earth from those closest to me, he never has rejected me. Those are the arms that I have run to in my darkest moments. And in my brightest days, I never forget that I am here because of his grace and his love for me. I served in the army for almost 7 years, and I was a paratrooper, and there were so many moments that I could have been killed on training exercises, on various different things. And even in that day, in that road in Iraq in 1991, where I faced a difficult situation and God spared my life. God, I can tell you with absolute certainty, is not out to kill you. Because if he was, he wouldn't have sent Jesus to die for you. But there are things that we do that take us out of that secret place of the Most High. They take us out of the shadow of the Almighty. That we take matters into our own hands, where we take our own destiny into our own hands, where we reject the counsel of the Lord, where we reject the counsel of God. There are things that we do that pull us out of that place. And God is so gracious up until the very end. But the more stubborn we are and the more willful we are, the more the enemy has a right to come in and to attack us with infirmities, with sicknesses. Because God's intent is Jesus came to give you more life and more life more abundantly. But my daddy's the type of dad who will roll up his sleeves and he'll work with you, labor with you. He likes to see me happy. He gives me all things richly to enjoy. He's a constant companion, a constant friend. When I'm afraid, I run to him and he just delivers me out of all my fears, all my worries and all my concerns. He surrounds me with his favor, with his increase, and he teaches me through my hard and difficult times how to deepen my relationship with him by being still. The message that I shared with you today is not just a message that came to my mind. It's not just something that the Lord gave me. It is a lifestyle that God is teaching me to live, teaching me to walk this out every single day of my life. And that peace and that serenity that comes from that quiet life has begun to unleash healing in my physical body over ailments and things that I've been, chronic things that I've been suffering from for many, many years. And it's not something that's happening overnight. It is a slow process, but it is a very deliberate process. Because he has said, I know the plans that I have for you, Joaquin. You may not know what those plans are, but I know those plans. And they're plans for good and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. I know that my daddy is there day or night, morning or evening. He is somebody who I walk with, who I talk with. He's my constant companion and my friend. And because he is, I have known a life where I rarely am afraid. Fear comes and goes. It doesn't pitch a tent in my life. I do get afraid and I get fearful. But like David, he said, when I am afraid, I will run to you. And I run to my God. This poor man cried out to the Lord, and the Lord delivered him out of all his fears. Not some of them, not a few of them, all of his fears. But you have to come. In Revelations it says, come. Come to the river of life and drink freely. Come. You have to come and you have to drink. Many of us come when we don't drink. And sadly, some of us don't even come at all. We want to try to work out our salvation with our own sweat and our own tears and trying to earn a salvation that was freely given to us on that cross. Your Father loves you just the way you are. Don't try to fix yourself, but rather position yourself in a way that God will then work in you to transform you. Because true transformation is effortless. True transformation that comes from God is not something that I work up or try to earn or try to do, but it comes effortlessly. And I want to read the scripture verse. For the spirit that God has given you does not make you slaves and cause you to be afraid. You shouldn't fear is not from God. The scripture says that he who fears has not been perfected in love. What is the perfection of love?
is knowing in your heart that God loves you just the way you are. That there's nothing you can do to taint that love. There's nothing you can do to lose that love. There's nothing you can do that can separate you from that love that was so freely demonstrated on that cross. Instead, the Spirit makes you God's children. And by the Spirit's cry, power, we cry out to God, Father, my Father. And I put Daddy, my Daddy. He's my Daddy. And if you don't know this wonderful Daddy, I want to give you an opportunity, if you stayed through this whole message just out of curiosity, whether on YouTube or on Facebook, who is this Daddy? He is God the Father. He is Jehovah. And he's my Father. And he could be your Father. So pray this prayer with me. Heavenly Father, I come to you now in the name of Jesus Christ, who died on that cross for me and shed his blood for me, so that I might be made your child. And as your child, I receive Jesus as my personal Lord and Savior. I become your child, and all of my sins, past, present, and future, are wiped clean because Jesus took them on the cross. And Jesus also took my sicknesses and my infirmity. And Lord, all things that are mine are yours. My marriage, my children, my family, all the things, the people that are important to me. Send your Spirit to bring them to the point where they will accept you. Because salvation is not just for me. As the jailer said that morning, sirs, to Paul and Silas, what must I do to be saved? And the jail, and Paul said, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you and your household will be saved. I receive that now in Jesus' name. Amen. God is a wonderful God. And he's a wonderful Daddy. All because of grace. Grace that was so richly poured out on that cross is the reason why you and I, as God's children, are exempt from his wrath, from his anger, from his disdain, from his rejection. We're exempt from it. To abide in that secret place of the Most High, to abide under the shadow of the Almighty, is to stay in his love. Regardless of what your senses tell you, regardless of what your memory, yeah, but this and what about this? My friend, learn to let it go. Learn, and God will teach you so many things in this period of being still. And when everything goes back to whatever the new normal is going to be, don't lose what you've learned during this period. Let it anchor you for what's to come. So, Selah, it means let's pause and calmly think of these things. And before I close the service, I want to ask Pastor Sharon to come and to sing this beautiful song that has meant something to both of us. And really, I hope that you take those words in and that it may touch you. Sweetheart.
Good morning. Good morning. It's good to be back. It's been quite a while.
Yes, it has.
It's good to be by your side this morning. It's good to be with all of you this morning. And a happy Father's Day to all of you, to all of you fathers out there, and to my precious father. This is a very special song. Actually, I probably should use my phone. This is a very special song to me, especially during this season, for what God has brought me through physically and even mentally coming through this. It's been a long journey. But I'm offering this song to my Father in heaven. This is just a song that I'm giving back in worship to him. And also I'm dedicating this song to my dad, my earthly dad. This is a song that from time to time we sing here at Pure Grace, Were It Not For Grace. And this is one of his favorite songs. He really enjoys this song. So Daddy, this is for you this morning. And I couldn't give you the original version. There's many renditions of this song, but Larnell Howe Harris sings a beautiful rendition of this song. But because of Facebook regulations, we can't play that original version. So you're kind of stuck with me this morning. So you know what, don't listen to my voice, don't listen, is she off pitch, on pitch? Listen to the words.
Yes.
Enter into the heart and the spirit of this song. And as I close my eyes and sing this to the heaven, to the Father, I pray that this song will minister to you beyond the music and the song, but that the words will minister to you too. Let me make sure I'm all hooked up here. I think we're a go.
Missed this one. We've had a new day transmission, but I want to close, I want to end there. I think the song said it all. It's a beautiful song and a wonderful song. And we plan to, for those of you who are following us for our New Day show, we've taken a pause to allow Sharon to recover. And we're not sure yet when we'll be coming back. Sometimes, I mean, this, what you saw here is actually a testament to the power of the Spirit of God, because if she talks for too long, she'll start coughing. And she was able to do this song beautifully and render it unto the Lord. And so I want to just bless all of you and thank God for you. Thank God for you know, your faithfulness and to Him, first and foremost,
yes,
and to our church family. I want to thank our church family and who has really been very faithful in their financial support of this ministry, even during these difficult times. It really speaks to the heart of all of you, your hearts for us, your prayers. Above all, we covet and we appreciate. So, the prayer that Abraham prayed over the nation of Israel, he said, may the Lord bless you. But if you're a child of God, you're already blessed. So the Lord has blessed you. The Lord has kept you and will continue to keep you. He has showered you with His favor. He has given you the radiance of His countenance, not as Lord and God, but as Father, as Daddy. And He has given you His shalom peace, a peace that surpasses all understanding. And may that peace guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus until we come together again, or we meet each other on the way up to meet the Lord Jesus in the air. God bless you. Amen and amen. So we'll see you next week, God willing, 11 o'clock next Sunday. And we'll be, if without, hopefully no technical difficulties, transmitting live here on Facebook and on my YouTube channel. God bless you.